Well, please do take a seat, and kids, if you would like to come join me at the front, that would be fantastic. I will be looking for volunteers. If you're in the sides, the easiest way is to come via the back and come straight down the middle, actually, and then it's easier to find yourself a space. Great, and while they're coming to the front, could the rest of us find page 998, please, which will get you to Titus chapter 2, and Hannah so beautifully read to us a few of those verses earlier on. Great. Well, we've just sung that God's Holy Spirit is our help, so let's pray and ask for his help now, because we're going to need it. Father God, we thank you for your word, the Bible. Thank you that you want to speak to us, you want to challenge us, you want to encourage us through it. And we pray, Father, that you would help us to pay attention to what you have to say to us today. Help us to understand in our heads and to have hearts and minds that are open to what you have to say to us. In Jesus' name, amen. So it's nearly here, isn't it? Yep, it's nearly here. Oh, yes, it is. And I don't mean the Liverpool game this afternoon, Katie, no. We've had Climber's Nativity. By the time we get to this evening, the last of these candles will have been lit and then snuffed out and removed. Sam Tufton is ready. No, not Sam Tufton. Sam Reed. Maybe Sam Tufton as well. Sam Reed is ready to inflate 600 or 700 balloons at the back there, hopefully with some people to help him. Then we get the Brussels sprouts in the pan of water to give them a good soak before the next day. And then it's, you know, last minute present wrapping and an early night because the next day it is
Christmas!
That's because Dan did it earlier on, isn't it? Yeah, you've lost all enthusiasm. Yes. I reckon 7 days, 20 hours, and 8 minutes until 7 o'clock on Christmas morning. And 7 o'clock, guys, on Christmas morning is the absolute earliest you should be making any noise whatsoever if you want your grown-ups in any kind of decent mood for the rest of the day. But so what? So what? Christmas. What's the point? Does Christmas change anything? Well, in the bit that Hannah read to us earlier on from the Bible, the Apostle Paul says, yes, there is a huge point, and it changes so, so much. You see, Paul is writing a letter to a guy called Titus. So here's Titus. I have absolutely no idea whether he looked anything like that. But Paul and Titus were going around telling people about Jesus. And then Paul had sent Titus to a place called Crete, where he told him to go and leave the church there to be in charge of the Christians, be like heap big minister there in the church. And Paul writes this to Titus. He says, "For the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all people. It teaches us to say no to ungodliness and worldly passions and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in this present age." That's a lot of words. And some of them quite big words as well. So, we need to try and make sense of it all. What on earth does it all mean? Well, I need a couple of volunteers, and I'm going to choose, I'm going to have you two, I think, to start with. Right, up you come here, and one of you stand this side, and we are going to call you Barney, and we are going to call you Fred for the next 10 minutes, or next few minutes, all right? So, Fred and Barney, and let's imagine that Fred and Barney are in the same class at school, all right? You're in the same class, and Paul says this: the grace of God has appeared. The grace of God has appeared. What on earth is grace? Well, grace is a wonderful name for girls, and there are a couple of you with the name, except it gets a capital G, doesn't it, when it's a girl's name. But what on earth does it mean? Grace means something amazing, and Fred and Barney are going to help us to understand it. So let's imagine that all year, I'm not picking on you, but all year, Fred has been really nasty to Barney at school. All right? So saying some really nasty things. Go on. And making some really nasty faces to him. Yes, all that kind of stuff. And maybe even doing some of that kind of nasty nipping stuff. Right, all year at school he's been really nasty to him. And let's imagine that Barney here saves up all his money. That's a lot of money there. Saves up all his money. And at the end of the term, he goes to Fenwick's, the big fancy shop in Newcastle, and he buys something really special. Let's imagine that he buys, you don't get to keep the money as well. He buys, something like a really expensive games machine or a really expensive watch or something really fancy, some fancy clothes or trainers or something. And then he goes round to Fred's house and knocks on the door. Knock, knock, knock. Fred opens the door and Barney gives him the present and says, "Merry Christmas." The next question's easy. Does he deserve it? No, he doesn't remotely deserve it. Was it a cheap present? No, it was a very expensive present. Who paid for it? Barney did, didn't he? And that, guys, is grace. That is grace. Grace is when we totally deserve nothing, and yet somebody gives us something huge and amazing and generous that's really expensive, and it's free to us because it's paid for by the person who gives it to us. And that, guys, is Jesus. What did Paul say? For the grace of God has appeared. You see, Jesus, that baby in the manger, could you hold on to that for us? Jesus, that baby in the manger who came at the very first Christmas, is a gift to you and me that is so amazing and wonderful and generous because it's God's own son. And it's given to us even though we are sinners and we totally don't deserve it. And Paul says that gift brings salvation because it's much more than just about Christmas, isn't it? It's also about this. Why Jesus came to die on the cross to pay the price for your sin and for my sin and then rise again to new life so that sin is defeated and we can be accepted into God's family as his sons and daughters. Could you hold on to that, please? Thank you very much. Salvation, rescue. So here's what I want you guys to do. You see that orange table at the back there? What I'd like you to do is probably go around that way. Could you head back and could you put those things on that table all the way at the back there as quickly as you can? Go and plonk those things on that table at the back. And when you've done that, guys, could you come and just come and have a sit back down over here? Brilliant. Let's put them on the table at the back. Superb. Thank you very much indeed. Great. Let's give them a round of applause as they come and sit down. Thank you very much indeed. And why did I ask them to put them over there? Because that has happened. That has happened. Jesus has come. Jesus has died and Jesus has risen. But is that it? No, there's more. Because look, while we wait for the blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. So Paul says that he and Titus and all of us now are waiting for the appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus. Because one day, Jesus is coming back. Jesus is coming back as king. And Jesus is coming back not just as king over a little bit, but he's coming back as king over the whole world and over everybody in it. Jesus is coming back. The Bible promises that when he does so, everybody will recognize that Jesus is king over everybody and everything. So, that's over there in the future. And that's all happened in the past. And we are all facing this way. Well, actually, I'm not facing this way. You are all facing this way. And the guys in the galleries, you're going to have to use your imagination a little bit. Facing this way, waiting for Jesus to come back as king. And the big question is, What do we do while we're waiting, in between what has happened and what will happen in the future, while we're waiting? Do we just kind of sit there, you know, with our arms folded, like we're sitting on some huge celestial travelator moving inexorably towards Jesus' return? You have no idea what I've just said, have you? No, neither have I. No, we can't. Because if we're trusting in Jesus, then we are changed. We have to be changed by what has happened and by what will happen in the future. Look at the things that Paul says have changed. While we wait for the blessed hope, the glorious appearing of our great God and Savior Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us to redeem us from all wickedness and to purify for himself a people that are his very own. Right, I need two more people to help me. Two more people. Yes, do you want to come and help? And who else? Would you like to come and help? Yep, come on then, up you come. Up you come, you two. Trying to find some people we don't normally choose. You come and stand over here. Great. And you come and stand here. That's brilliant. Okay, so let's look at what Paul says. That if we are trusting in what Jesus has done, then we are redeemed. We have been bought back. Jesus has paid a huge price for us to come back. So could you put that in one hand, please? Put that in one hand and give that a wave. We are redeemed. With enthusiasm, yes, we are redeemed. And he says also we are purified. We've been made clean. Our sin is forgiven forever. Put that in a second hand. Great. And give both of those flags a wave. Great. We are also purified. But also there's more. We have hope. Not just any hope. Not just the hope that someone will buy me a nice new car or something for Christmas. But a cast iron guaranteed hope. That this is not all there is, that Jesus is alive and he's coming back. So in your third hand, could you put that and give it a wave? There you go, in your third hand. Give that a wave, fantastic. And also there's more, because Paul says we belong to Jesus. Paul says we are his very own. We are redeemed and purified people. We are precious to him. Brothers and sisters, you and I are precious to Jesus. So precious that he went to the cross to buy us back. That's how precious we are. Have you got four hands? No, you don't have four hands, but you have lots of fingers. Well done. Give them a wave. Go on. All of those things are things that have changed. Brilliant. Okay, guys, you can go and have a seat. Thank you. Let's give them a round of applause, shall we? Thank you. So if we've been changed like that, then we have got to be different, haven't we? If Jesus has done all that for us, then we have got to be different. Look at what Paul says about what waiting for Jesus looks like. Verses 11 to 13. For the grace of God teaches us to say no to ungodliness and worldly passions and to live self-controlled, upright and godly lives instead in this present age while we wait. Did you see that? The grace of God teaches us to say no to ungodliness. In other words, guys, we're changed. We can't be changed and purified and belong to Jesus and have that hope of Jesus' return without being changed, without being different. So, when the world says, hey, make yourself number one. Yeah, I need to make sure that I'm okay first. The grace of God teaches me to say no. Jesus is number one, just like we sing, guys, yeah? Jesus is number one. I'm waiting for my King Jesus, who's coming back. When the world says, look, do what feels good. Do what feels right to you. The grace of God teaches us to say no. Do what Jesus says is good and right. Why? Because I'm waiting for when Jesus comes back and I've been changed by what he's done for me. And when the world says, this is all there is. So experience as much of it as you can. You know, your bucket shop. Your bucket full of things that you need to get done in your life. God teaches us to say, no, this isn't all there is. I'm looking that way. I'm looking that way towards when Jesus is coming back, my King Jesus. And do you know what, guys? When we live differently like that, when we live differently, that is actually attractive to people who aren't yet trusting in Jesus themselves. Did you know that? People look at Christians living differently and they are attracted to that. What makes you different, Mr. Christian, Ms. Christian? It's Jesus. It's Jesus who makes me different. It's Jesus who came at that first Christmas and who died on the cross and who rose again for you. So if that's you today, if you've been attracted by watching your Christian friend and seeing them live differently, you're attracted to that, then the answer is Jesus, who's done all that for you. Will you put your trust in him? And for those of us who belong to Jesus already, let's ask God every day for his strength to say no to ungodliness, to say no to it, but instead to live lives that please King Jesus every day as we wait for his return. And let me pray for us now. Father God, thank you for your grace, your amazing gift of Jesus, who has appeared, who died, who's alive, and who one day is coming back as King over everything and everybody. Help us to live for Jesus, changed by all he's done for us. And please may others be attracted to Jesus as a result. In his name, amen. Right, guys, thank you for listening so well. You can go back to your grown-ups in Pewland, and we are going to sing our next song, which, actually, when you look through the lyrics of this song, it really summarizes everything that we've been thinking about now, about Jesus coming at that first Christmas, his death, his resurrection for us, and his return. Let's stand and sing together.